Okay, let's talk about muscle energy theory for a little bit. Photo of me from when I was younger, hair was a little bit longer. Didn't really speak English then, but I managed to learn it pretty quickly. And that's all the Schwarzenegger jokes I got. Let's talk about muscle energy. Fred said, very tongue-in-cheek, I like Fred, those of you, so I'm sure some of you in this room know Fred. He's another country doctor. This is not a scientist at all. This is his father. I never met the father. But Fred Mitchell Jr., if he's still alive, he's got to be in his middle 80s, somewhere around there. Just very country, plain talking. Country doctor to me is, if that term doesn't mean the same thing to you, country doctor is DOs who are doing family medicine, delivering babies, as Lou Hasbrook would tell you if you're out in the Midwest, taking bullets out of legs, not from homicides as we're having in the inner city, more from hunting accidents. But they're doing everything, and then they develop some technique within the osteopathic scope that was useful. Fred said to me, he said, this is what I asked him, tell me, saying this over a meal, over dinner, he said, tell me, you know, how you came upon muscle energy and all this. Just before I interviewed him, when I came into town, he says, well, yeah, this is what my father developed to teach his son who didn't know how to do manipulation very well. That's what he said, very, very tongue-in-cheek. So in the osteopathic world, his father is credited with this, and he fully credits also a PT, and I should really dig out the name because I don't know who it is, but says that somebody in the PT world was developing the same techniques at the same time, same idea, and he readily gives credit that they weren't working together and so forth. But these ideas actually go older than Fred Mitchell, because even the Lippincotts, which were contemporaries of his but older in Philadelphia, they were doing post-isometric relaxation and so forth. And that's only in the brief osteopathic history. Osteopathic history is a brief in the world of manipulation in the last 150 years, to be honest about it. In the world of bone setting, who knows? You just go back thousands of years. So this is who's credited in the osteopathic world. Fred Mitchell Sr., yes?
Did you say that he was the one who said that gapping is...
Fred Jr. has said to me that if you feel that bump, this facet is compressed. Okay. Phil Greenman has said to me directly, no, it's obviously open. And Fred said to me, I hate him. And Phil never carried a message back the other way. You know, osteopathy is that Thanksgiving dinner table where you gotta have these ones sitting far away from those ones. And some people need to be at the kids' table and some people can't be in the same room. That's what osteopathy is. And everybody loves to wave the flag like, this is my way and it's the only way and we're all gonna agree on that. Especially, we're not going too far into it, but in the cranial world, that's where you're gonna get the most nuttiness and the most attempted collusion. If I would send John to Viola Fryman and to Upledger, if we could resurrect him, and to Bill Wyatt and Dr. Fulford and all people that I respect, and say, tell me the key lesion in this cranial mechanism. And I said, write down on a piece of paper, hermetically seal it away into this tea bottle and we'll open it. I guarantee you they'd have different answers. But there's an attempt in our profession to say that they would all have the same answer. They do little things to try and make it look this way.
So
one person gives the answer, another person touches the big toe and says, yes, I agree. That wouldn't happen if you went in their office, in my opinion. Yes?
But the point is just to get that specific feel, not so much. I mean, since everybody has a different idea on what that is, what we're trying to do is...
Well, not everybody has a different idea, but there's two camps of thought. But either way, if you're localized to it, and we're going to get to it to do the actual techniques, if you're localized, your forces are correct, you have a good chance of this working. And I'll explain reasonably why it should be working. Because of that picture behind John. Because it's the entire segment that's not moving. I can say it directly wanted to go this way, it indirectly wanted to go that way. You just get it moving any which way, which means your forces are localized, you have a good chance of it working. The principles are really simple. This is patient active, so this only works if your patient can and will follow instructions. For your patients who just will not listen to you, you can't train them to follow things, this is not going to be one of your better choices. You're going to place the patient's somatic dysfunction to a restrictive barrier, either where it wants to go or where it doesn't want to go. You're going to instruct them to generate some sort of force. That's the muscle energy. That's where the name is coming from. The easiest way to do this will be for the practitioner provides isometric resistance to the patient's effort. Isometric is I'm not moving, you're not moving. We have other variations on this that we can do where they are moving, And what becomes difficult, not difficult, but what you need to get under control is localization. Once your forces are localized, this is really key. You're going to ask them to do some effort, you're going to instruct them to stop their effort, then you're going to reposition them, take them to a new barrier, whether it was direct or indirect, and keep repeating the process as much as you need to. Isometric, this is really what the easiest way to do it. Isotonic is when their forces are overcoming you, and isolytic is when you're doing the same thing and you're overcoming them. Isolytic, for those of you who are weightlifters, is kind of like the negative reps if you're doing bench presses. So you can hold somebody in a position and say, okay, move in this way, and if they overcome you and you allow them to overcome you, it's an isotonic technique. If you say move this way and then you force it further the other way, it's isolytic. Isolytic is generally painful for people. But sometimes these are nice to mix it up so that people aren't, they start predicting what you're doing, and it's nice to mix it up. Also, muscle energy works as a perfect precursor to mobilizing them. If you want to do a little bit of mobilization, do some myofascial, some muscle energy, and then take it a little bit further. I don't do violent muscle energy. I do sort of low violence, not muscle energy, low violence, high velocity thrusting. One of my colleagues in school who helped me with a lot of thrusting was a chiropractor before osteopathic school. And his famous statement to me was, "Steve, I could crack a tree." I said, "Maurice, I am so happy for you that you can crack a tree. I have no, that's so far out of my comfort zone doing things like that." We can do things for reciprocal inhibition. Activate these muscles so that these ones relax. What you'll do that will be effective is to combine a lot of these ideas, not just one technique. Joints will mobilize when you're doing this. I know some people, some states are really restrictive on who should do what, who's allowed to pop a joint. But everyone in this room who represents already a lot of years in the tank knows that when you're setting people up, you might be just doing myofascial things, click and pop. So you can do it specifically because you want to mobilize a joint, or it'll just happen accidentally. Respiratory assistance, this is really nice for when we do the ribs. Now, the ribs are kind of complicated but very doable. You can always add in breath into the mix. And there's something a little goofy called oculocephalogyric reflex, which doesn't really have that much use, but we'll talk about it anyway, just so you will have heard it here. Oculocephalogyric reflex is something we're told we can use for quadriplegic patients. Okay, and that's followed by my answer, which is really followed by question mark, question mark, question mark. You got a quadriplegic, you're not doing muscle energy. But I'll explain what that is in a bit. Here's our barrier. I think we showed the same diagram or something like it. Anyway, for myofascial release, we're either going, this is me turning my head from left to right, and that's where I can go. That's a normal person. Okay, this second ring here. This, we're saying someone has a restriction here, which is the dark blue. They seem to be freer going to the right than the left. This is your evaluation you're making. Say you're doing the AA, and you say, oh, well, they like to turn to the right. They have some pathological or restrictive barrier. That pathological or restrictive barrier, the first restriction should be fascia, something like that, fascia adhesion, something that doesn't belong there. Or it's just hypertonic muscle, ligaments. It can be ligaments, and then really if we're going with ligaments and bone together, that's your anatomic barrier. So they can take themselves to a physiological barrier. This is what I can do. You can take them and turn them toward the anatomical barrier. And I'm not against that, by the way, taking them, doing more extreme motions. I just want to show you another side. I think a lot of the world will show you the really heavy, hard side, and that's how I was trained. And Fulford just gave me another side of the coin by doing these minimal things. And I found it to be very useful. Once you have a technique, then you have to have a theory as to why you think it works. Okay, so Dr. Mitchell says that, well, he thinks it's doing something to change either the Golgi tendon organ or the muscle spindle fibers, and you're resetting some mechanism. Maybe that's what's happening. Maybe it's just that you're stretching the fibers and allowing it to move more. Not just one theory. For reciprocal inhibition, this is your spinal cord. This is your spinal cord on drugs. Okay? And forget it. So, this is your spinal cord. You know, the cross-extensor reflex. This is a big reflex to get the cross-extensor reflex. But essentially, if we just take this side, in order for me to activate my biceps, my triceps, got to get a message to inhibit them. This is cross extensor where it's doing the exact opposite on the cord. You're not going to do a reciprocal inhibition technique alone, and that's going to be successful. We were taught that it just will not work alone and be successful. To inhibit the scalenes in your neck is going to feel fine. You might decide to do this side to inhibit the scalenes, this side to stretch the hell out of these other ones. So
I just want to be clear. So what are you doing to inhibit it?
It is inhibition. If I want to inhibit these scalenes, I got to do something to activate these ones. Okay, hold the head, do something. Would say push. But if this is really a problem and these are hypertonic, you're not just gonna, that message is not going to be enough. So you're really gonna mix these all together. So what are the reasons that you're going to do this? You're gonna do it whenever somatic dysfunction is present, Marissa. And whenever there is a need to normalize muscular relationships, improve local circulation, respiratory function, lengthen, normalize restricted hypertonic muscles, mobilize restricted joints. These are our reasons for doing this. Who aren't you going to do this to? It's not really rocket science, but the fracture, probably a bad idea. Try and mobilize the fracture. Severe sprain, how are you going to know it's really severe? Because you're going to try and do the technique, and they're going to tell you it's too damn painful, and they're not going to let you do it. So they're really going to let you know about this. And then my favorite category, which I had many of in my practice, the uncooperative, unresponsive, are those who cannot and will not follow directions. Okay. In my training, I used to like to do muscle energy. We did a lot of it, and I used to, in my stronger days, used to like pick up big legs and stuff because I could. And every guy that I tried to do this on, that was like 60 or 70 years old when I was 30, and I'd wind up their knee up to my chest, and I'd say, just push gently, and they would thump me right in the chest. Just like, I think, to show me that they still got something left at the end of their life, okay? So, you know, you have to instruct your patients. It doesn't require maximum effort. It does require you to localize your forces. It's a really nice technique, and we can break it down to a few categories when it doesn't work. Either your diagnosis is just completely wrong. Not that it was rotating to the left or rotating to the right. Just it's not that segment at all. That's not the problem. That's one big problem. The other one is inaccurate localization of forces. You're holding their neck and you're compressing all over the place and your forces are distributed amongst a couple of joints. That's going to be the biggest problem, that you're inaccurate. Lastly, incorrect forces, duration of the patient's efforts. This is all kind of like a stew. We learned originally 5 to 7 seconds. Someone else told us it has to hold for 3 to 5 seconds, and I do it for less even than that. I ask them to move, turn. So there's these rules. But it should be a short duration that you're asking them to do the muscle contraction. Short, controlled duration. If you go very, very long, you're going to have them contract for 15 seconds. You know, this is probably too long. They're not going to they're not going to be able to maintain consistency. Most people are not going to be able to be consistent. You want a consistent, sustained force in an isometric way is the easiest way to put your toe in the pool. Questions on this?
I feel like whenever this has been done to me, that it never really did anything. I'm really flexible, and I just felt like someone could just push a little bit harder each time and get huge results. You know,
okay.
Especially with like my hamstrings, they could just like lean on me and then here and here. I've never felt like it.
You never felt like it did anything for you. So that brings us to 3 conclusions. A defective therapist, a defective patient, or it's just not a good choice for you and what your problem is at the time.
Right.
You know, I don't get married to that. Somebody just wrote me something just crazy from India. I've been working with this group now, so we've had 4 classes. And one of the guys writes to me, he's got somebody with tinnitus, and what I showed him didn't work. I love that. Okay, he went around the vault, he did it, didn't work. Tell me another technique to do. I'm supposed to teach him through texting how to do another technique. I mean, I applaud the enthusiasm, and I wrote back to him, like, just get some more practice.
Yeah.
He writes back to me again, well, I want another technique. It didn't work. So I wrote, well, you didn't work. And sometimes I don't work. You know, I don't help her. You know, I don't help everybody. By a mile do I help everybody that walks in my door. Tinnitus, I think Paul asked me, and I said, you know, tinnitus for me is about 20%. And some of you, maybe it's better, maybe it's worse, who knows what. But I'm about 20% being able to make a change or make it go away if it's idiopathic, if there's no other reason for it. If you guys got a better track record, I take my hat off to you. But the guy's writing me, well, I did the technique you just showed me, and it didn't work, so to text me another technique and send me some snapshots of what I can do. And you're all laughing, those of you who've got time and rank here, because it's the technique applied by a certain person, and not everything's going to work for everybody all the time. It's just not going to.
With hypermobile people, if I can say that, or really stretchy people, would that kind of be a common?
It really invites me to say yes, but I just can't base that on any kind of numbers.
Okay.
And I don't ever have the muscle energy session. My session can best be described as a bastardization of cranial, visceral, and myofascial, a lot focused with those three, little bit of everything else that I've done with you. So I haven't isolated and say, just can I do muscle energy technique and will that work? When I was entering medical school, they were just starting to do a study, a long-term study, I don't know what the end result of it was. We'll do some techniques now. They were doing a long-term study on headache. What technique worked better for headache? Cranial, muscle energy technique, something, something, and a sham technique. And they wanted to invite me into being part of the study. And I said, well, how are you going to control for the operator?
Yeah.
And they said, well, we're doing sham OMT. Well, I don't believe there is such a thing, actually. I believe if Catherine or if John touches somebody with the intent to help them, I don't even know how, honestly, I don't think that you, I'll pick on you, John, I don't think you could touch somebody with the intent of thinking a baseball and not helping them. I don't think it's in the machine. And it might be therapeutic just that you touch them. So you can't compare us like you can with drugs. And even with drugs, I already have told you about, the doctor comes in, gives you narcotic, doctor comes in, says I'm giving you narcotic. You know, it's hard to control for the idea of someone caring for you. Even a total racist like Bobby Fischer, because he was really a Nazi supporter, apparently. He really thought Hitler had some good ideas. Bobby Fischer, the chess player, he said a quote, something, there's nothing so healing as the human touch. And I found that mind-numbing from a guy who thought Hitler was a good guy. That falls into the stop clock is right twice a day category. So there is something in just human touch, and human touch that's knowledgeable, and human touch that cares. There is no sham. So.